And after Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who were trying to take the child's life are dead. So he got up and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus, who was Herod's son, was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Archelaus was quite a beast. And having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, he will be called a Nazarene. I thought we would just identify with a couple of characters in this story, and maybe with a place in this story. And so maybe let's take a couple of minutes and look at Joseph, the obedient. Joseph was a man who knew how to live by faith. He'd been living by faith ever since the announcement of this baby who was coming. He was engaged, and then, you know, the pregnancy occurred, and he's going to put her away. And then, no, the Lord says, you know, you need to go through with this. And then the birth of the baby, and no room in the inn, and the angels, and all that kind of thing. Joseph is an average guy, and he now is a man walking by faith. I think Joseph knew he wasn't the key player in this thing. This wasn't about Joseph. This was all about the baby. But Joseph absolutely carried the mail for his part. Think about the time that they had when the Magi were there. What an amazing time. What a high time for them. And the gifts were presented, and here were important people. Imagine for Joseph, who was an average guy, to live through that thing. And Joseph had no idea of the danger that was lurking. But God spoke to him about the danger to his boy. And when he knew it was God, he acted right away. It's a good thing, because the troops are coming tomorrow. Bethlehem is 6 miles from Jerusalem. It doesn't take a long time to get there. And the decree is going out, and those boys will be dead tomorrow. But Joseph obeyed right away. And when those troops came to the town of Bethlehem, Joseph and Mary were already on the road. They were about 15 miles out of town already. And they were heading toward Egypt. Imagine if he would have not obeyed when he knew it was the Lord. Once in Egypt, he waited for the Lord to talk to him again. But he used his smarts in not moving to Judea under Archelaus, but to Nazareth, which was safer for his young family. May we identify with Joseph, the obedient. May we not identify with Herod, the rebel. Josephus was a historian of Jesus' day, and he wrote this of Herod the Great. He said, Herod is a man of great barbarity towards all men equally. This is a picture. I just think this is amazing. This is the bust of Herod the Great. This is what the man looked like. It's like a photograph who killed the babies in Bethlehem and who tried to kill Jesus. He was extremely paranoid about threats to his throne. He killed so many people who he felt might have a threat, including his favorite wife, Mariamne. He thought she was maybe, you know, putting together some kind of a coup, and so he killed her. He felt bad about it later, but you know, what's done is done. And killed most of her family. And over time, he killed 3 of his sons, including one 5 days before Herod died. Herod lived from 73 BC to 4 BC. So Jesus was born 5 or 6 BC, somewhere in there. And Herod was nearing the end of his reign. He was a grizzled old man. He was an angry, paranoid old man, and he was dying painfully and terribly. You read Josephus' death of Herod, and it is awful. So he was coming to the end of his time, and yet he wanted to control the kingdom. It's interesting. You know, he's coming to the end. He's feeling lousy. And yet he hears a threat to his throne, and he's going to clean it out. And how did he find out about the Messiah to be born? Through all of his people. In Jerusalem, he said, read to me. What's this about something in Bethlehem? And so they read to him the scriptures about Messiah. But it's very interesting how he decided to respond. Just kill the guy. Like, scripture means nothing to him. Prophecy means nothing to him. His throne means everything, and he wants to clean out the usurper. And typical of his style, he had all the little boys in Bethlehem. It says, in Bethlehem and its vicinity. So you cast a wide dragnet. You want to make sure to catch anybody who gives you a problem, and that's the way he did it. And so he had all those little boys killed. And these little boys were the first casualties in the war between the kingdom of the world and the reign of Christ. And it's interesting, Jesus didn't want his kingdom. He didn't want to usurp Herod. Herod's kingdom was far too small, for Jesus is King of kings and Lord of lords. And also, Herod hadn't been outwitted by the Magi, but he was outwitted by God. Ultimately, Herod the rebel made futile gestures. Let us identify with Joseph the obedient and not Herod the rebel. Now let's talk just for a minute about Egypt the refuge. When you think about Egypt in terms of the Bible, you don't think in terms of Egypt as a positive place. You think in terms of Egypt as a negative place. It is a place of bondage. It is a place of the Pharaoh. But here in this passage, it became the place of safety for the Holy Family. Now, this wouldn't be the first time that Egypt was a release valve for troubles in Israel. You can go back to the book of Jeremiah, and because of problems with Babylon, many, many Jews fled Israel and went to Egypt. In fact, the city of Alexandria in Egypt, which is right on the water, doesn't that look nice? Wow. At Jesus' time, had a large, large Jewish community. In fact, that's where they translated the Greek version of the Old Testament, the Septuagint. It was done in Alexandria. So there were many Jewish people in that place. And I think that's probably where Joseph took the family, was Alexandria. And kind people would have helped them there, and he would have plied his trade there. And we don't know how long they lived there, but that's where Jesus lived for a while. It's interesting to me in this passage that Jesus was not delivered by a miracle. Like God didn't take care of the wicked old Herod. God didn't deliver by a miracle, but they were delivered by fleeing. And you just think, God with his son, this little boy, wouldn't God just sort of clean all the junk out of the way? But instead, they had to flee. And I think this is true of us sometimes as well. Sometimes I think we have to go to Egypt rather than seeing a miracle. And that which seems perhaps to be the place of bondage is instead a place of safety. A place of second best. It's like what happens when you don't get the position that you were seeking and they give the position to somebody else. And there you are in the place of second best. You're in Egypt. Or when you're seeking a healing and you don't get the healing that you're seeking, and so you have to go through, you're taking pills and you're getting operations and all that kind of thing. Or when you're not accepted into the program this year. Somebody else is accepted into the program and now you're living in Egypt. Or when you want to have a baby and it's delayed, and so you live in Egypt. Or the house doesn't sell when you need it to. Or when the timing seems off and we have to make do. We kind of live in Egypt. Maybe this interim time has been set aside for you. And maybe instead of what you think is a place of bondage, maybe instead it's a place of refuge and safety. You know, God had prepared this family for this issue because they had received gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh, expensive, expensive gifts. I think this is what paid Joseph and Mary's way to go the 350 miles or so and live in Egypt for a while. Maybe God, Maybe God, in your interim time, has already prepared you in some way for what you're experiencing. And finally, let's just talk for a couple of minutes about Jesus the refugee. So we've looked at Joseph the obedient and Herod the rebel, and then Egypt the refuge and Jesus the refugee. So here is how the King of Kings left Bethlehem for Egypt. He left humble, a political refugee. And maybe this informs us as to how to treat people who have fled to where we are. We're in the midst of sponsoring a Syrian family who are refugees out of Syria. And I'm not sure when we're going to get them here, Brian, but we're working on it. We're working on it. And certainly I think we need to be wise that we don't transport a bunch of suicide bombers here. Jesus was not a suicide bomber. But I do think we need to be wise in that. But we also need to recognize that Jesus was a refugee, and we remember the Son of God on the road to Egypt. Beyond that is verse 15. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. That's from the book of Hosea, and it really doesn't have anything to do with the Messiah in Hosea. It has to do with the Israelite people. And if it weren't for the Holy Spirit, we would never apply this verse to the Messiah. But the Holy Spirit applies it to the Messiah. And it tells me that there is something grander at work here. Jesus was certainly a refugee with his family to Egypt. But I think there's also something greater here to be said to us. Remember when the children of Israel left Egypt? Remember after 400 years of bondage? And then they were to leave Egypt and they're to become a nation? God called them out, and he worked through the great leader who? Moses. Moses. Think about this. Like Moses, Jesus was pursued by a murderous king. If it weren't for Moses' mother putting him in a little basket and sending him down the reedy Nile, what would have happened to Moses? So these two deliverers were pursued by a murderous king. And like Moses, Jesus was a fugitive from the king and ran into the desert. Moses was called by God to deliver the people from physical bondage, and so too Jesus was called by God to deliver from spiritual bondage. I believe this is a picture, and this verse is a picture of the new exodus of the people of God. Jesus leads us out of bondage by his life and sacrifice. He is the leader for the people of God. So in our passage this morning, we see Joseph the obedient. We see Herod the rebel. We see Egypt the refuge. We see Jesus the refugee. What does Egypt in the Christmas story teach us? I think it just teaches us maybe just three things that I leave with you this morning. Egypt in the Christmas story teaches me to choose the right side. Will I be Joseph or will I be Herod? Herod beat against the walls of brass. It was not going to change. Do not contravene the purposes of God. Egypt in the Christmas story teaches me to be like Joseph and not like Herod. Secondly, this passage, Egypt in the Christmas story, teaches me that if I am in an Egypt of some kind, I need to seek to find what God has for me there and to consider that it might be a place of refuge and safety for me and to listen for him when he says it is now time to go. And lastly, Egypt in the Christmas story teaches me to follow the liberator, Jesus, the one who takes me out of Egypt at the right time into the promised land. In him is found freedom from bondage. Some good thoughts from the country of Egypt, one of the homes of the holidays. Next week, we're going to talk a little bit about the most contested piece of real estate on the planet. And we'll give that a little bit of time You know, provided we don't have another deluge, we'll see. Would you stand with me as we close our time? It's been great to have you here this morning. I am so glad that you made an effort to come for the kids. I think it was a real, it was wonderful for us. I think it's also a blessing for the kids. So thank you for making the effort to come today. I don't know if Kelly Huebner is here, but he was out clearing our lot today, and we really appreciate his effort. It is slippery, as you know. Some of you talked to me about it, and you landed on your backside coming in, so you won't do it going out. But those of you who didn't, you be careful, all right? Let me bless you in prayer, and then we'll let you go. Heavenly Father, thank you for our time this morning. It's been inspiring to listen to the words of Scripture from our children. And we pray your blessing on each one of these children. Be with all those who led this morning and have done a lot of work. And we ask that you would reward them in ways that money cannot. And now I thank you for each one who has come this morning. And I know there are many who would have loved to have been here and could not. I pray your blessing upon them. I pray for those particularly who are living in some kind of Egypt, some kind of interim time. And I ask that they would keep their ear to the ground for when you say it is time to go. But in the meantime, that they would seek the safety and the lessons that you have to teach them in Egypt. So thank you for our time today. It's been an unusual Sunday, but it's been great to meet with you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, everybody. Safe travel.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and heaven.